We never go. Surprising delays for Artemis moon landing. Hey guys, you know that old saying about milk on the stove? Apparently, if you stare impatiently at the pot on the stove, the milk will seem to never boil. And that's kind of what's happening to us right now with this long-awaited space age 2.0 that always seems to be on the verge of exploding and finally projecting us into that future we've always dreamed of, and instead seems to enjoy slowing down right at the top moments. We are about to leave, we are about to discover, we're on the verge of, we're about to launch, we're going back to the moon with the James Webb Telescope. We will solve all mysteries of the universe. They tell us and we tell them over and over again, but then, at the best part, something always goes wrong and you never get to the point. Until a few days ago, for example, we were almost convinced that the Artemis I mission, after years of delays, would be launched in December or, at most, the first days of January. And instead... Instead, on October 21st, NASA's new director, the aging former astronaut Bill Nelson, announced that the launch of the first mission to the moon after a 50-year hiatus will be further delayed by a couple of months. Basically, an attempt will be made to take advantage of a launch window that runs from February 12th to February 27th. But what's worse, NASA's management has formally renounced the goal of getting humans back to the moon by 2024, pushing back a landing of NASA astronauts on the lunar surface at least until 2025. Bill Nelson attributed the delay to the legal dispute between Blue Origin and SpaceX, the coronavirus pandemic, and the change in some other projects related to space exploration. But in reality, even before these problems, the 2024 deadline had seemed too ambitious to most observers and likely to the space agency's own managers. The 2024 deadline had been set by former US President Donald Trump, who imagined being able to celebrate the new moon landing in conjunction with his last year of presidency, in the event that he was reappointed in the 2020 presidential election, later won by Joe Biden. The new political course had then changed several executives within NASA, including the administrator. But even Nelson at the beginning of his tenure had still reiterated the commitment to bring an astronaut to the moon by 2024. He continued to repeat it last summer, at a time when it was clear that it was impossible to meet that deadline because of the many delays. In fact, the development of the Artemis program in recent years had been slowed down mainly by difficulties in the development of the Space Launch System, the large rocket that NASA wants to use at all costs, and at all costs is not just a way of saying to push to the moon the Orion transport capsule, which will host the crews of the various lunar missions. The rocket is only one part of the complex series of vehicles and systems that will be needed to return to the moon. In fact, NASA has yet to finish the development of new spacesuits necessary to protect astronauts from the lunar environment, and at the moment is not even ready with the lander, that is the vehicle that will allow the crews to descend on the lunar soil once reached the orbit around the moon. A lander that, we recall, will have to be provided by SpaceX, and that has been at the center of the dispute with Blue Origin. You already know how things went. NASA had decided to contract out the development of the lander to private parties, trusting in this way to accelerate its realization. The initial plan was to entrust the practice to two different companies, to stimulate competition and at the same time have at least one alternative if something went wrong. Among the candidates, NASA had chosen three finalists: Elon Musk's SpaceX, Jeff Bezos's Blue Origin, and Dynetics, a company that often works with the US military. However, the agency had to revise its plans when it failed to obtain the required funding from Congress to finance its activities. So it decided to go ahead with a single company and choose SpaceX, which prompted Blue Origin to appeal by starting a complicated legal dispute that was resolved only a few days ago with the confirmation of SpaceX. According to Nelson, that controversy would have strongly influenced the development of Artemis for almost 7 months, in which NASA could not work with SpaceX in the design of the plan for the lunar landing. The lander will be anyway Starship, the giant spaceship that SpaceX is experimenting in Texas, and that in Musk's plans will be used one day to reach Mars, starting the colonization of the planet. To date, however, Starship has not yet reached Earth orbit. The earliest date for the first orbital flight test is next March, and it is not even clear how it will be used to make the moon landing. In theory, the crews will leave the Earth aboard the Orion capsule, pushed by Space Launch System. Once reached the lunar orbit, the capsule will then connect to Starship, with which astronauts will be able to reach the moon. The plan must be perfected, and there are still many details missing. Not to mention that, in addition to Starship, has never been tested, even Super Heavy, the large SpaceX rocket, 72 meters high, that will carry and orbit the spacecraft. Artemis I will be a preparatory mission, so to speak, to test the performance of both the rocket and the Orion capsule, and to acquire data to fine-tune the future phases of the Artemis program. In fact, although unmanned, the Artemis I will not be an empty mission. On board, there will be 10 CubeSats with varying science and engineering goals. Some of the more interesting include Lunar Ice Cube, which will look for ice on the moon with an infrared spectrometer, and NEA Scout, which will deploy a solar sail and navigate to a small nearby asteroid. A Japanese CubeSat called Omotenashi will impact the moon with a solid rocket booster, while Argo Moon will maneuver around the SLS upper stage taking high-resolution images. Still in draft form and waiting to pass a battery of final tests, the mission is counting on setting a series of firsts in space exploration. It will take Orion farther, faster, and to higher temperatures than a human transport spacecraft has ever endured. In fact, there is talk of going 60,000 kilometers beyond the moon and re-entering the atmosphere at almost 40,000 kilometers per hour and at temperatures of 2,700 degrees Celsius. And all this for a journey of at least 3 weeks and over 2 million kilometers. Once the first test is over, it will be the turn of Artemis II, which will be very similar to the previous mission, but with a crew on board. The launch is now scheduled for May 2024 at the earliest instead of 2023, as was previously announced. The crew will reach lunar orbit but will not perform a lunar landing, which will be up to the next mission. It will bring for the first time a woman to the moon and the first person of color, according to NASA's plans already announced some time ago. In another startling announcement, Nelson also said that Artemis III will be preceded by an uncrewed landing mission as part of the Human Landing System contract awarded to SpaceX. Although not entirely unexpected, this is the first NASA declaration of commitment to an uncrewed landing. NASA officials did not say what the mission number will be. The uncrewed landing likely will allow for more stringent tests of the reliability of Starship, which Nelson said has not had enough congressional funding. Just to warn Musk, who in some of his statements had given the impression of playing with the idea of descending first to the moon with Starship launched by his rocket Super Heavy. NASA said it was against the idea of a direct landing of SpaceX, but Nelson said he was willing to consider any other alternative for future options, which sounds like a death knell for the use of the Space Launch System in the years to come. Nelson also stressed the need for the Artemis program to be more efficient, warning America of China's long-established ability to bring men to the moon at any time. He also promised that NASA would be as aggressive as possible with their timeline to beat our competitors with boots on the moon. A very colorful joke, which certainly will not have gone unnoticed in international politics. And speaking of boots on the moon, someone pointed out that between delays and legal disputes, in the last update on the Artemis program released by NASA, there is no mention yet of a well-defined landing site, but it is limited to outline the necessary characteristics. Adequate solar illumination to ensure light is a source of energy and reduce temperature changes, ideal location to ensure communication with the Earth, terrain suitable for both landing and lunar walks that the movement of rovers, and even proximity to areas perpetually in the shade as a possible source of ice. Some precious clues could come from the patrols of Viper, the rover part of the Artemis II mission, for which the landing site has been recently announced, near the Nobile crater at the lunar south pole, one of the coldest areas of the solar system. Nobile crater, dedicated to the Italian polar explorer Umberto Nobile, is an impact crater that was formed through a collision with another smaller celestial body, almost permanently covered in shadows, allowing ice to exist there. Smaller, more accessible craters surrounding Nobile's perimeter will also provide Viper with ideal locations to investigate in its search for ice and other resources. The area Viper will study in the Nobile region covers an approximate surface area of 93 square kilometers, 16 to 24 kilometers of which Viper is expected to traverse during its mission. During this time, the rover will visit carefully chosen areas of scientific interest that will provide further insight into a wide array of different kinds of lunar environments. The Viper team will look to characterize ice and other resources in these areas using Viper's sensors and drill. As Viper moves among each area of scientific interest, it will collect samples from at least three drill locations. Analysis of these samples from a variety of depths and temperatures will help scientists to better predict where ice may be present on the Moon based on similar terrain, allowing NASA to produce a global resource map. This map and the other science Viper will produce will allow scientists to better understand the distribution of resources on the Moon and help inform future crewed missions to establish a long-term presence on the lunar surface. For now, the plan is to allow the first astronauts who will set foot on the Moon at least four extravehicular activities, during which it is expected to recover about 30 pounds of lunar samples to bring back to Earth. All this is about to start again with Artemis I. And it's not long now. We have to believe next February 12th, the reconquest of the Moon will really begin.